Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
So inshallah we're going to get started. So the plan is to go until, because there's a lot of material, we'll go until 7:35, 7:40 inshallah. We'll pray Maghrib. After Maghrib we'll have pizza and then I'll quickly finish off the ending. And then we'll end it off with the Q&A. So save your questions for the end instead of now, because it's just going to ruin the flow. But yeah, jazakallah khair for coming out. This is a topic that I know interests a lot of people, and I'm excited for this. All right. So I want to begin with this quote. So education is our passport to the future, for tomorrow belongs to the people who prepare for it today. Now I find the last part powerful, because the people who are controlling the future are going to be the ones who are preparing starting today. It's not that you start preparing for today and you start controlling the society now. No, you start preparing now for the future. This summarizes Malcolm, I feel like, really well. So terminology. So I'm going to be using some of the terms that Malcolm uses. So I'm going to be using words a lot like to refer to white people. I'm just going to say white man. And for black people, the black man, because that's how Malcolm uses it throughout his book, and it's easier. So primarily he'll focus on his biography, but I really want to focus on his legacy, because his legacy is where we'll learn the life lessons that are applicable to us. And again, save the questions until after the lecture. All right. Now the social context. Now, I'm pretty sure everyone's familiar with the civil rights movement. I believe we even have some classes at SFU on it. But just a brief recap. The civil rights movement was a struggle for social justice that took place mainly in the 50s and 60s for African Americans to gain equal rights under the law in the US. The Civil War had officially abolished slavery, but it didn't end discrimination against blacks. They continued to endure the devastating effects of racism, especially in the South. By the mid-20th century, African Americans had more than enough of the prejudice and violence against them. They, along with many whites, mobilized and began an unprecedented fight for equality that spanned through decades. So I don't think I need to go into that in any more detail. We all know what happened in the social right, in the civil rights movement. Now, Malcolm, so innocent. Now his childhood. So he grew up in Omaha, Nebraska. Omaha, Nebraska, during his childhood is similar to how it is today, where it was primarily white people, a lot of racism. Even today, there's still a lot, and there were very few black people living in Omaha at that time, aside from Malcolm's family. Now, a key to understanding Malcolm's childhood is his father, because Malcolm began to emulate his father later on in his life. So his father's name was Earl Little, and he was actually a Baptist minister, and he began to preach Marcus Garvey. And Marcus Garvey was a black nationalist who was stating that black people need to be liberated, they need to stand up for themselves. And Malcolm's father, Earl, he loved Marcus. However, because of those sentiments, he got into conflict with the Ku Klux Klan. And they would constantly get conflict with one another. The Klan would come to their houses and just get bricks and just shatter their windows. They would threaten Malcolm and his family that we're going to kill you all. And there was always conflict between them just because of Malcolm's father. Now, eventually, one day, Malcolm's father, he got into an argument with Malcolm's mother, and he left the house late at night. And, you know, she had a really bad vibe, and she just couldn't sleep the whole night. And tomorrow, the police came in, and they said that, you know, Earl had been murdered. And, you know, there was speculation as to how he got murdered, but the strongest opinion is that he was, in fact, murdered by the Ku Klux Klan. And so what happened is they kidnapped him, they attacked him, and then they tied him to train tracks, and then a train ran him over. And so his whole skull was just dented in. And so Malcolm never forgets that. And the key to understanding this is that the Ku Klux Klan were white. This is very important. And so after Malcolm's father passed away, Malcolm's mother, because Malcolm had seven siblings, so it was one mother taking care of eight children. And so she began to work full time, and then the insurance company came, and again, white people. And what they said that Earl actually committed suicide just so his family could receive the insurance. And this was something that Malcolm found crazy, his family found crazy, because they knew their father was murdered, and they knew he was murdered by the Klan. However, you know, again, what Malcolm was saying, it was the insurance company, you know, filled with white people. They hated us. And as a result, the insurance company made a plan. And then their idea was that we don't have to pay them if we put Malcolm and his siblings into foster homes and separate them with his mother. And they claimed that Malcolm's mother was crazy because she wasn't eating meat. Nowadays, they're just called vegans. But they actually ended up splitting up Malcolm and his family, and they called Malcolm's mother crazy and they threw her in a mental asylum. And then Malcolm, at 27, he goes and he visits his mom, and his mom doesn't recognize him anymore. And she doesn't recognize any of his siblings. And Malcolm has a profound quote about that. But again, for Malcolm, he just saw that, you know, it was white people that were doing this to him. And as a young child, he noticed these things. Now, the last incident is what happened at school. So him and his siblings, they were put into foster homes. And now he was going to school. Malcolm was the only black person in his entire grade, and there were very few black people within his school. However, he was the smartest person in his entire school. He was class president. Everybody recognized that Malcolm was the smartest. One day, an incident that shocked Malcolm the most is that he was sitting with his teacher one day, just privately. There were no students. It was just him and the teacher. And the teacher asked him, "Malcolm, what do you want to be when you grow up?" And mind you, Malcolm, again, was the smartest person in his entire school. Smartest person. And he says, "You know what? I want to be a lawyer when I grow up. I think I'd be a good lawyer." And I want to read the exact quote that his teacher responds to him with. There's a lot of papers. So he says, Malcolm's talking about the teacher. He said, "I know that he probably meant well in what he advised me that day. I doubt that he actually meant any harm. It was just in his nature as an American white man." He said, "Malcolm, one of life's first needs is for us to be realistic. Don't misunderstand me now. We all here like you. Just, you know, be realistic. You gotta be realistic about being a Negro. A lawyer? That's no realistic goal for a Negro. You need to think about something you can be. You're good with your hands at making things. Everybody admires your carpentry work. Why don't you plan on carpentry? Your people are good at being working at carpentry. You get all kinds of work." Now, this was profound, and throughout Malcolm's autobiography, he mentions this. He says, "I was the smartest person in the class, but why can't I be a lawyer? I was smarter than all of them. Just because of my skin color, I couldn't be a lawyer? I think that's racism." And so the key here is the Klan killed his father, white people, the insurance company that drove his mom crazy, split his family apart, and threw his mom in a mental asylum were white people, and his school life, because of that incident with the teacher, he was a white man. There was another incident also where in history class, he was learning about history, and they had one paragraph in the entire book on black history. Just one small paragraph. And while that was being read, the teacher was just laughing, dropping the N-word all the time. And because of that, Malcolm began to despise school. He started to hate school just because he's like, you know, what kind of history am I learning here if only one paragraph is on black history? And later on in his life, when he reads countless volumes on black history, he realizes how corrupt the system is. But you need to understand his childhood to truly understand where he was coming from and how he became who he did. Now his teenage years. So eventually, he was sick and living in the area in Nebraska, and he eventually moved to live with his older stepsister Ella. And this is where Malcolm began to get introduced to the nightlife. This is where he began, because he got a job as a shoe shiner for musicians. And so while he was there, he was in downtown, and he was living in the ghettos at this point. And he just saw all types of black people. He saw the lower class, the middle class, and the upper class. He didn't even know upper class existed until this point. And so this is where he began to, you know, sell drugs, he began to gamble, he began to smoke, and he began to rob houses. And so he was a prominent drug dealer at his time. That's how he was making his money. he began to move away and he stopped living with his sister Ella, and he just began to sell drugs. He would take the train all around New York and Boston, just selling drugs. And this is important to note for later on, that he was a prominent drug dealer, he was prominent at gambling, and he smoked as well. He was a complete alcoholic. He was addicted to alcohol like crazy, and he began to rob houses. So you can see that he was the epitome of the lower class African American, that he was at the bottom of society with everything that he was doing. And so it's vital to understanding his life to realize that. And what he actually did, if you look at this picture, because this hair isn't natural. It's clearly not natural. So what he did was he began to emulate the white man. And so he would create this powder and he'd put it in his hair and it would literally burn his scalp. It would burn his scalp and he'd be screaming just so he could get hair like this to imitate the white man. And he says, this was my first really big step towards self-degradation. When I endured all that pain, literally burning my flesh to have it look like the white man's hair, I had joined that multitude of Negro men and women in America who are brainwashed into believing that the black people are inferior and white people are superior, that they will even violate and mutilate their God-created bodies to try to look pretty by white standards. So he's saying he was just, you know, he just fell into whatever society was doing, and he was just like every other African American. That he just wanted to be a white man. He knew black people were second-class citizens, and he was fine with that. He was fine with that. Now he concludes this chapter by saying, "All praise is due to Allah that I went to Boston when I did. If I hadn't, I'd probably still be a brainwashed black Christian." This is powerful. This is later on in his life when he's recalling it. And later on, you can see through every step in his life, he always gives praise to Allah. He always says, "All praise to Allah for getting me out of that lifestyle." He says, "All praise to Allah. Without Him, I wouldn't be who I was." And this just shows you, you know, his spiritual side as well. Now, I have a lecture. I mean, this is video I want to show. Again, about self-degradation.
Who taught you, please? Who taught you to hate the texture of your hair? Who taught you to hate the color of your skin to such extent that you bleach to get like the white man? Who taught you to hate the shape of your nose and the shape of your lips? Who taught you to hate yourself from the top of your head to the soles of your feet? Who taught you to hate your own kind? Who taught you to hate the race that you belong to? So much so that you don't want to be around each other. No, before you come asking Mr. Muhammad, does he teach hate, you should ask who yourself, who taught you to hate being what God gave you.
Now this is powerful because that's Malcolm later on in his life when he's preaching and he's saying, "I've been through everything that he's preaching." It's something that he's been through, and he's saying, "Why should we imitate the white man so much that we burn our scalp, and we change our bodies just so we can be like them?" He's like, one thing he says later on is that if by doing this, did we actually become first class citizens, or are we still second class citizens? Now eventually. You know, he was a prominent drug dealer. He ended up moving to Harlem. And everybody knows that Harlem's a spot. For African Americans, Harlem's a spot. And that became his home. And, you know, he continued doing the same things. And he ended up living in an apartment where a good chunk of the people there were prostitutes. And because of that, he got in a lot of contact with them. They saw him as a little brother. But again, it goes to show you the lifestyle that he was in. That he was hanging out with these prostitutes, with these drug dealers, with these gamblers, with prominent gang leaders, and he was involved in this lifestyle. And it's interesting to see that he was involved in all of this, and you end up seeing what he actually ended up becoming. That he was, again, at the lowest of society, and he ended up being Malcolm X, who we know as of today. Now, then eventually, he began to go all in house burglary. and he began to break into houses all the time, him and his friends. And something interesting he mentions is because, you know, he was a prominent house burglar. He's like, I'll give you a tip to prevent your houses from being robbed, right? It's a very practical tip that I'm pretty sure everybody does. He's like, nobody will ever rob your house if you leave one light on. He's like, if you leave one light on, we have to reconsider. He's like, we're just not going to do it. He's like, it might still happen. He's like, however, there's one place in your house where you can put the light on and nobody will ever break into your house. Never. He's like, in the bathroom. He's like, if you leave a light on in the bathroom, he's like, people can be in there for hours, you just never know. He's like, the worst thing is if you go to break into a house and somebody's actually awake. So he's like, it was just a practical tip that he wanted everyone to know. And so what him and his friends did is he had two white girls. Now it's important to remember that. So two white girls and him and his other friend who was African American. And so the girls would go to people's houses in the morning and they would say, we're just here for a survey. You know, we just want to ask you questions. And they'd be let inside the house. And after they were inside the house, you know, they just asked these questions, but they would look at where all the jewelry is. They would see where all the cash is. And then later on, they would tell Malcolm and Malcolm's friend, and at night, Malcolm and his friend would go in and they'd break into the houses. And so they were doing this constantly until one time they broke into a house and they stole, you know, all this jewelry, and they stole this really expensive watch. And so Malcolm, you know, he was really dumb at that time. Like, he was really dumb. He ended up getting that watch, which was broken, and ended up taking it to a mechanic to get it fixed. And that mechanic was in their neighborhood, right? He was so dumb. He says later on, he's like, I don't know why I was so stupid. And so eventually, once he gave it in, the guy whose watch it actually was, he's like, nobody's stupid enough to actually come to this mechanic and give it, but Malcolm did. And when he came to pick up the watch, he got arrested. The police came, and they opened up Malcolm's apartment, and there was just a bunch of jewelry in there. There was all these watches, jewelry, cash, drugs, everything. Like, it was over for him. And so he got arrested, the white girls got arrested, and his friend got arrested as well. And so they were all put in court. And the very interesting thing is that the white girls got 2 years in jail, a 2-year sentence. But Malcolm and his friend got 10 years. And so at that point, Malcolm realized how corrupt the system was. He began to understand how corrupt the system was. And again, he saw that the judge was a white person. The lawyers, even on his side, were going against him, and he knew it, they were white. And so in his life, all the white people he dealt with were horrible. They treated him horribly, and they just hated African Americans. And so Malcolm was sent to jail to serve. He ended up serving 7 years. But he ends off his trip in prison with a very profound quote, which is my favorite quote in the entire book. He says, I want to say before I go on that I have never previously told anyone my past in detail. I haven't done it now to sound as though I might be proud of how bad I was, of how evil I am. But people are always speculating, why am I as I am? To understand that of any person, their whole life from birth must be reviewed. All of our experiences that happen in our life fuse into our personality. Everything that ever happened to us is an ingredient. Today, when everything that I do has an urgency, I would not spend 1 hour in the preparation of a book that had the ambition to perhaps titillate some readers. But I'm spending many hours because the full story is the best way that I know to have it seen and understood. That I had sunk to the very bottom of the American white man society when soon now in prison, I found Allah in the religion of Islam, and it completely transformed my life. That's very powerful. Now, one thing that I find very powerful from this quote is he says, people are always asking, how did Malcolm become Malcolm, right? Because you don't just end up like that. He's saying all of our experiences that happen in our life, all of the incidents, they shape into who we are, into our personality. Now, if we reflect and just think about our own personal lives, at one point there was a major incident that probably happened in our lives that changed who we are. There might have been multiple of them, but there's always one incident which truly changed people. I know for most Muslims, including myself, you know, they're not really as practicing Muslims. However, something happens, an incident happens. And after that incident, you see the change. And then they stop going from their parents forcing them to pray to them praying by themselves. There's always an incident. There's always something that happens. And another thing that he's saying is that, you know, self-reflection is key. A lot of the people here, you know, you make friends the past couple months or even a year. But a year ago, even a couple months ago, you didn't even know that person. They weren't even part of your life. And now they might be your best friend. You might be always hanging out with them. But just a couple weeks ago, you didn't even know. And again, the last thing he says, and this is why I really encourage everyone to read his autobiography, because he says, I could have spent 1 hour making this book and it would have been fine. He's like, but I spend many hours because I know that's the best way for this book to be, and this book will change people. And the last thing is that I had sunk to the very bottom of the American white man society when in prison I found Allah and I found the religion of Islam. Right? He was at the lowest of society, and that's when he found Allah and he found Islam. And because of that, he completely transformed his life. Now, Malcolm's prison years are key to understanding him, and it's key to understanding why Islam is the fastest growing religion in prison. For those who don't know, Islam is growing at a rapid rate in the prison sphere. And to understand that, you need to understand why prison was so effective for Malcolm. One second. Now, Malcolm was sentenced to prison for 10 years. However, he only spent 7 years. And something interesting, do we have any criminology students here? One criminal, this was here? Oh, okay. So something interesting criminology students should know is that, again, this is anecdotal evidence. However, this is evidence he arrives to and many inmates. Is that when you ask an inmate after they leave prison, you know, what's one thing that you don't forget about prison? And they'll always say that, you know, in prison, you know, I forget everything. All of the incidents that happened, you know, I forgot about it. All the times, you know, anything happened to me, forgot about it. However, there's a consensus between all of them that the one thing that they never forget, the one thing they never forget are the bars in prison. He says that sticks with him and the inmates for the rest of their lives. The fact that they're being caged like animals and that they have no freedom and they have nowhere to go. And he says, you know, he says some of them even experience PTSD when they think about these bars, because then it brings all of the memories, all of the dark times that happen in prison just when they see those bars. So that's something very profound that he mentioned. Malcolm's nickname in prison was actually Satan. They called him Satan, you know, Shaitan. Right? He was a horrible name to give him. But he said himself that he was so anti-religious at this time. He said he hated God. He said, you know, because he grew up a Christian, he's like, I hated the Bible. And in prison, he would just yell out how much he hated God and how much he hated, you know, the Bible and everything. And so in prison, you know, you're not referred to as your name. They give you a number. But for Malcolm, he was just known as Satan. And everyone just called him Satan, which is something very profound, because when he leaves prison, he's super religious. But when he first entered, his name is Satan, and he hates God, right? It's one that you don't believe in God, but to hate God is another extreme. And so he met this man in this picture. His name is Bimbi. And again, look, he's just, even in prison, he's burning his hair. Nobody's there to see him, but he's still burning his hair just because he was in that lifestyle. But this man, Bimbi, comes to him and he changes Malcolm. He says, why are you burning your hair? He says, don't you know black people, and this was shocking to Malcolm. He said, don't you know black people are actually better than white people? And Malcolm's like, what do you mean? He's like, black people are better than white people. He's like, I don't know where you got this image that we're inferior to them. And he begins to question everything Malcolm does. And a key thing, a very key thing, is what Malcolm found profound was this character. And even when you listen to people convert to Islam, they'll always say a key thing is that their character. the character of the individual. So Malcolm was really struck by his character. And now there's a video I'm going to show you.
Did you ever study anything that wasn't part of some con?
What the hell for, man?
Come with me. Black, destitute of light, devoid of color, enveloped in darkness, hence utterly dismal or gloomy, as the future looked black.
Pretty good with them words, ain't it?
Soiled with dirt, foul, sullen, hostile, forbidding, as a black day. Foully or outrageously wicked, as black cruelty, indicating disgrace, dishonor, or culpability. And there's others. Black male, black bald, black guard.
Someone.
Let's look up white. Here. Me.
White. Of the color of pure snow. Reflecting all the rays of the spectrum. The opposite of black. Free from spot or blemish. Innocent. Pure. And this something without evil intent. Harmless. Honest. Square dealing. And honorable. Wait a minute. This is written by white folks, though, right? This is white notebook.
It sure ain't no black man's book.
So what are we reading this one for?
Because the truth is lying here. If you read behind the words, you got to take everything the white man says and use it against him.
A whole lot of words in here.
Here. Let's start at the beginning. We'll look them up. Write them down. Find out what they mean. Here. Page one. First word, aardvark.
Aardvark. Earth pig. Looking at you in the mouth. Chinese. Calculating.
Now, just to recap that video, it was very profound that he was reading it, and when he came across black, it said guilty, right? And when he came across white, it said innocent. And then you could see at the ending, he's like, you know, this is written by white people, and he's like, obviously. You know, what do you think? You think a black person is going to write this stuff? And so this is where Malcolm begins to change now, where, you know, he begins to change in his life. And, you know, I mentioned black male, black ball. These are the same things which Muhammad Ali also says when he converts as well. He's like, you know, he's like, why isn't it called white male? Why does it have to be called black male? And again, it just shows you again, this is the beginning of Malcolm's life. So in the video clip, it shows that he takes him to the beginning of the dictionary. Because Malcolm was a grade 8 dropout. He never went to school after grade 8. And this is important for later on when he's going and he's giving all these lectures. And so what he does is he starts at the beginning of a dictionary. And he starts at aardvark. And he writes down the entire dictionary, all the periods, all the apostrophes, all the commas. He writes all of that down. Because he says that he tried reading a book, but he couldn't even read the simplest of books because his education was horrible. And so he says that he wrote out the entire dictionary, and after that he was able to start reading books. And once he started reading books, that's when his life changed. That's when his life changed. Now he read books that most of us here can't even read. He read books deep on philosophy, deep on genetics. And the book on genetics was very interesting because he read the book on genetics and he said, the book on genetics showed me that the first person, the first human had to be black. It's impossible for the first person to be white. He says, it's impossible to get a black person from a white person, but you can get a white person from a black person, which substantiated his belief that black people were the first people on earth, which coincides with the Islamic belief as well, that Adam alayhi salam had dark skin. And so he found this very interesting because he was always taught that the black man came from the white man. And it was only through reading the book on genetics. He ended up reading a bunch of books on philosophy. And he said that there were only three things that were happening in my life in prison. He said, I was sleeping for 3 hours a day, I was eating barely, and the rest of the time I was just reading. He said, I was always reading. And so at nighttime, they closed all the lights in the prison. However, outside of Malcolm's cell, there was a little light bulb. And so he would go and he would read right outside there. However, a prison guard would come every hour to make sure everyone was sleeping. And then he'd quickly go to his bed, and then he'd go back and he'd start reading. And he came into prison with 20/20 vision, and he left with glasses. Which just goes to show you how much he was actually reading. How much he was reading. And again, he was reading constantly. He was reading thick books. Now, his brother wrote a letter to Malcolm. He said, Malcolm, I have converted to the Nation of Islam. He said, I don't want you smoking anymore because I know you're addicted to smoking even in jail. And I want you to stop eating pork. Now at this point, Malcolm, he didn't know why, but he just trusted his brother. And he stopped smoking, he stopped eating pork. And so his brother came and visited Malcolm. And he told Malcolm, you know what, Malcolm, you need to change the way you're thinking. He's like, there's a man, his name is Elijah Muhammad. You know, we're following his teachings. And through his teachings, we're finding out that the black man is actually superior to the white man. And their belief, right, very crazy. They believe that all, not some, not most, no exceptions, every single white person was a devil. Every single white person was a devil. Every single. That's their basic doctrine in the Nation of Islam. That everyone was a devil. And so Malcolm was shocked. Because he began to reflect over his life. The fact that the KKK, white people killed his father. The insurance company, white people, they screwed over his mom and threw her in a mental asylum. And his teacher who was white. And he began, and the judge as well. And so he began to realize that this is true. White people are all the devil. And he believed in this. And so what he started doing is he started writing letters to Elijah Muhammad. And he started, you know, he was just writing letters to him all the time. And Elijah wrote back to him. And so you could see they had this constant communication with one another. And Malcolm eventually converted to the Nation of Islam in prison. Now, a very interesting thing is, does anybody know what the most famous prison in the world is? It's closed down now, but does anybody know what the world's most famous prison is?
Alcatraz.
Now, Alcatraz is located in San Francisco. I actually went to Alcatraz. Not as an inmate. But I actually went there to visit it a while back. And so when you're in San Francisco, you have to take a boat because Alcatraz is on an island. And the worst of inmates were put into Alcatraz. And if you go into Alcatraz, the inmates are particularly interested in philosophy. That they were very interested in philosophy because when you're put in prison, you're beginning to question your life. What is the meaning of my life? Why am I put in here? And again, you can just see Malcolm read philosophy extensively. He just constantly read it. But I do have a funny story when I was in Alcatraz. Is when you first enter Alcatraz, they give you headphones. And you can hear what inmates are saying in previous interviews. And so, you know, my whole family went, and, you know, I was walking through all the cells, and the cells were open, right? The beds were there, I was just looking at it, and it was very interesting. And so the boat was leaving, and then they're like, oh shoot, where's your dad? And I was like, oh my God, we lost him. And so I'm searching everywhere, I'm calling him, he's not picking up. And then I'm walking, and then eventually I find him. And he's sleeping in the bed of an inmate. He's just sleeping there. That was the most profound thing I learned from Alcatraz. Because they have the cells open and you can walk in and the beds are just there, right? They're horrible beds, but I guess he was just listening to it and then, you know, like, just took a quick nap. But that was very interesting. But again, in prisons, they begin to question their life. And if you... And they have so much free time that if you actually listen to what these inmates are saying, they're beginning to question their entire life. And they look at religion extensively, including philosophy. Now, nothing shocked Malcolm more than the history of slavery. I'm pretty sure we're all familiar with this history of slavery, especially in America with the transatlantic slave trade. And Malcolm just read it, and while he was reading it, he would just start crying. because these were his people. And this is what happened to his people, but this wasn't being taught in the schools. Like I mentioned, only one paragraph was of black history in his school. Only one paragraph. The rest was just on, you know, European history. And so when Malcolm was reading about this, he began to realize again, white people were killing black people. They were treating us horribly with in slavery. And so as he began to learn more about religion, he began to debate pastors. Because, you know, the pastor would come and all the inmates, you know, they're at their lowest. And he's like, you know, just believe in God, you know, trust in God. And so Malcolm goes and Malcolm debates him in front of everyone. If I have time to play the video. I do. I really want to play the video. It's only a minute long.
I put all of them up.
I can't find it well. But basically what he does is, he gets into an argument with the pastor, and he says, because the pastor was a white man, and he said, what color were the disciples? And he's like, you know, they probably had, you know, they had a bit, you know, he's like, he was a bit stuck. And Malcolm's like, they were colored, right? And he's like, yeah. He's like, so, Jesus was black, right? Jesus was not white. And then the pastor goes and there's a picture of, you know, white Jesus. He's like, can't you see Jesus is white? He's like, can't you see? It's right there. And so Malcolm's like, you know, the Israelites, you know, they had dark skin. He's like, yeah. So he's like, because there were all these inmates. And he ended up winning the debate. And then it was very interesting because he was arguing that Jesus was black, which shattered their entire beliefs. Now, that was basically what happened in prison. But his chapter on prison, he goes extensively as to the life of an inmate and what goes on through your mind and what was going on in his mind. And he constantly got into these debates proving that the Nation of Islam was correct and Christianity was false. He continued doing this until he was eventually released out of prison. Now, so his 7 years were up and Malcolm was finally free. He began to live with his brother in Detroit, and he frequently started attending the Nation of Islam mosque. So 3 days a week he was going there, he was just learning more and more and more, and he was immersing himself in this lifestyle. And then yearly they have a national convention which Elijah Muhammad goes to, and that's where he met Elijah Muhammad and his faith grew even more. And, you know, that's where he really began to love the Nation of Islam. Now, his name is Malcolm X, right? His real name is Malcolm Little, but Malcolm X, what does that X mean? So the Nation of Islam, they believe that the last name that we have is from our slave masters, right? For example, if you have an African American whose name is like James Washington, you know Washington is not his people's name, it's his slave master's name. And so because of that, through history, they've lost their last name. I mean, one of the crimes is they don't even know what country in Africa they belong to now, right? Like most of us here, we can trace our roots back to, like, you know, Pakistan, India, Saudi, but they couldn't even, all they knew was Africa. That was it. And so they dropped their last name and they replaced it with X. And the X symbolized the unknown. Yeah, we don't know our last name, but we don't want our slave master's name. We want to liberate ourselves. And that's why they changed their last name. Now, just about the Nation of Islam quickly, because I've been mentioning it, but when you understand what the Nation of Islam is, they're called the Nation of Islam, but they're not Muslim. Okay, so they're an American political and religious movement founded in Detroit, Michigan. So they believe that there was a man named Wallace D. Ford, right? They believe that he was Allah, right? They believe that he was Allah and he came to Detroit. And he came to a man named Elijah Muhammad. At that time, his name was Elijah Poole. And he told him, you are the messenger of God, and I am God. And you are sent here for the African Americans. You are sent here to liberate them. And so he taught them their whole theology, their whole aqidah. And that's where he began to learn about the Nation of Islam. So they have something called Yaqub's history. So they believe there was a man named Yaqub who, you know, he was a scientist, and he created this species of people. white people. And he created them with the intention that they were going to be devils, and that all of them are devils, and that they were going to suppress and oppress the African Americans. And that's where they get their whole belief that all white people are the devils. And this became very problematic later on when the media would ask them these questions, and they did come in contact with good white people. Now, critics have described this new religious movement as being black supremacist and anti-Semitic. They were referred to as a black Muslim movement by outsiders. They were never referred, they were rarely referred to as a nation of Islam. They were always called the black Muslim movement, always. And they got a lot of criticism from the mainstream media. They got a lot of criticism from the media because the media were white people. And so obviously when you hear that all white people are inherently the devil, all these things begin, it's going to become problematic. So this is a picture of Elijah Muhammad, their main messenger. So that's exactly what the Nation of Islam is. All of the Arab countries at that time, they denounced them. They said they're not Muslim. And if they wanted to commit Hajj or Umrah, they would not be given the visa to go. They just weren't let in. They were just seen as outcasts. Now, Minister Malcolm. So eventually, Malcolm became a full-time preacher at his local mosque. And this is when he began to get really famous. It's because he was given this platform, and he was just speaking. And because of, and his speeches were so powerful that everybody was loving him. Everyone, all of the African Americans. And he was one of the greatest orators of all time. Public speakers. If you go on Google and you search up the greatest public speakers, orators, Malcolm X comes up there. And if you listen to his lectures, which are all on YouTube, you can see how great of a public speaker he was. Now he quickly rose up the ranks of the Nation of Islam. And eventually, Elijah Muhammad's health started to get worse, and he put Malcolm into the spotlight. And that's where he became famous. Because he was going to one mosque, and he would just keep preaching until they needed to build a new mosque there, and then he'd go to a different city. And then he'd go there, and then they'd build a new mosque, because he was such a great speaker, and the way he was speaking was just, he was grabbing the attention of everyone. And because of that, the Nation of Islam went from four mosques in all of America to 55 mosques because of Malcolm. And you know, he would fly four times a week. He was always flying to places, and he was incredibly devoted to Elijah Muhammad. He loved him. Like honestly, when I was reading it, it's like when you read like the seerah of how the companions loved the Prophet Muhammad
sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
It was like the same way he was in love with him. Is he did everything for him, he followed him everywhere, and he said, I believed in Elijah Muhammad as a messenger more than he did. That's how much he was in love with him. He loved him more than Elijah Muhammad loved himself. And so he began to go to all of these mosques and just start speaking, and then he became famous. One second. There's a lot of talking, man. Now, I think I have a video here. Okay, here. So Malcolm was, this was one of the most prominent scenes, prominent scenes in Malcolm's life. There was an African American who was beat by the police severely, and he was sent to prison. He was put in custody. And unfairly, he was beat right outside of the mosque. And so Malcolm got all the African Americans there, his mosque members, to go protest outside the mosque. And just listen to what happens.
Disperse this mob.
pay close attention to what the police officer is about to say. So after that cop saw that and he began to see Malcolm and he said that's too much power for one man, immediately he was put on the FBI list. Immediately. Right then. And then the FBI went to go all in on him and they searched into him. And the FBI does play a prominent role in the story, which will be discussed later on. But you can see from there that Malcolm could control all his people. Even though Elijah Muhammad was the leader, Malcolm was basically the leader. And as he began to become more famous, there was a funny incident in his life. You know, he says in his autobiography, I had always been very careful to stay completely clear of any personal closeness with any of the Muslim sisters. My total commitment to Islam demanded having no other interest, especially I felt no woman. In almost every temple, at least one single sister had let out some broad hint that she thought I needed a wife. So I always made it clear that marriage had no interest for me whatsoever. I was too busy. And when I read this, I was like, this is a man dedicated to his vision. It's like, this man, he's just focusing on his religion. It's all that matters. And then 3 pages later, he gets married. Right away. Go 0 to 100 real quick. Now, at this point, Malcolm was going on TV shows. He was going to universities and speaking. Like the same way where we have Islam Awareness Week and we bring in these speakers, people were bringing in to Malcolm. And he was speaking at Oxford, he was speaking at Harvard, Stanford, Yale, all of the prominent universities in the world, which I'll mention later on, he was speaking at. Everybody wanted him to speak because nobody could, because again, his style of his speech was, his style of his rhetoric was very persuasive. And everybody loved it. And the things he was saying, because he was going out in public and he was saying, you know, screw the white man for doing, you know, for putting our people in slavery and killing them. And then when the other PhD professor would respond against him, he'd refute his claims right away. And it's very, and again, remember, he had a grade 8 education. He had a grade 8 education and he was debating prominent professors with PhDs. Prominent professors. This is a man with a grade 8 education. Later on in his life, he was asked, what's your alma mater? And he said, books. Because in prison is where he had his education. And he says, the problem with colleges and universities is that there's so much bula bula. There's so much, you know, events, partying and stuff like that, that people can't even study properly. That, you know, they have events like these instead of studying. And because of that, you know, that's why their education is flawed, and mine is actually much better. Now he grew on the list of the FBI. The FBI started to tap his calls. All of his calls that he had, they started tapping, and he knew that as well. And he started his own newspaper called Muhammad Speaks, where he just began to propagate the message of Elijah Muhammad in the Nation of Islam. He continued to do that, and he grew. Now, this is where they got a lot of criticism. Eventually, all the media, all the intellectuals, they came together and they're like, you know, they were scared of Malcolm. Because the rhetoric that he was pushing is that our American system is flawed. All of it is flawed. And because of that, that's why African Americans are treated horribly. They're treated horribly because the system's flawed. The system is racist. And he says later on in his life that my economic, social and political philosophy is black nationalism. Now, when he talks about black nationalism, it's different than black nationalism talked about now. Because he said that he believed it was justified for the black man to take things into his own account. That you have a city like Harlem, where 99% of the people are black, but it's being run by a white man. The biggest stores are run by white people. So he really pushed for social, political, economic development for African Americans at this time. Now, like I mentioned, the doctrine of white people being the devil was problematic because a lot of white people reached out to them and said, how can we help you? You know, we want to help you. We know you guys are suffering. What can we do? And they said, get away from us. We don't trust you. Right? You guys, you people are the devils. Why would we want to trust devils? And they got a lot of backlash into that. The FBI began to send, to infiltrate their mosques. So when Malcolm would speak, they would put FBI agents inside, black FBI agents. And because Malcolm's talk was so persuasive, the FBI agents came and told them, we're FBI agents, but we're going to convert to the Nation of Islam now. Right? So he even converted the FBI agents. He continued to speak across all of America. Everybody wanted him. And so he says something very interesting. He talks about liberalism and conservatism. And he says, you know, there are two types of politicians. He says there's the one politician that comes out to your face and he says, I hate African Americans. I hate you guys. I'm not going to do anything to benefit you guys. And then on the other hand, you have the other politician who comes up to you and says, he says, oh, you know, we want to work with African Americans. We want to help you guys. But behind the scenes, they're going against you. And he says, I have more respect for that politician who comes to my face and tells me that I hate you and I despise you. Because he says, what happens then is that then you see the African Americans rise up. They started becoming activists. Because, and this is, you know, this is applicable to Muslims as well, right? Is that when, now what you see with Muslims nowadays, you see a lot of Muslims becoming activists. A lot of Muslims standing out for a lot of things. And the main reason being is because they see that there are policies that are going against them. But if the policies weren't going against them, they wouldn't, you know, they would just sit around. They would say the politician can deal with it. So what Malcolm's saying is that you need to liberate yourself, the African Americans. Take things into your own hands. Stop relying into these politicians. So that was something very interesting that he mentioned throughout his book. Now, he was put on a death list for $10,000. People wanted him dead at this point. And obviously, it was white people that wanted him dead because they were scared of him. The entire American system was scared of him. Now, something very significant happened. In Islam, one of the biggest sins, right, is zina, adultery. The Nation of Islam, it was the same for them. Adultery was a huge sin for them. And one thing I forgot to mention is the Nation of Islam, they had their own military called the Food of Islam. And if you actually committed sins in public, they beat you up. They beat you up. And so news comes out about Elijah Muhammad. And that, you know, he's been having sexual relations with his mistresses in all of his mosques. And he has 10 kids. And this goes out everywhere. And everyone is like, that's a huge sin. Was he actually doing that? Like, he's our messenger. He can't be doing something like this. And Malcolm just began to question everything. He said, how can this guy be a messenger? He's a hypocrite. Because he's telling us not to do these things when in fact he's actually doing it. He said, this man's a hypocrite. And so he goes and he visits Elijah Muhammad to ask him about this. And Elijah Muhammad says, oh, you know, just trust in God's plan. All this happens for a reason. Like, don't worry about it. He says this garbage rhetoric. Absolutely garbage. And so tensions began to grow between them. And then the people in the Nation of Islam, they got jealous. They began to become jealous of Malcolm because he was this prominent figure. And they said he was going to take over the nation before Elijah Muhammad died. Sorry, I'm very thirsty, man. A lot of time. And so, President John F. Kennedy got assassinated. We're all familiar with the story. JFK got assassinated. And so Elijah Muhammad told all of his ministers, don't say anything about it. Just keep your mouth shut. Don't say anything. The country loved that man. They loved it. Don't say anything. And so the media came to Malcolm. And, you know, he wanted to voice his opinion. Right? Because he was very vocal about these things. And so they're like, what do you think about the assassination of President John F. Kennedy? And he says, you know, it's a perfect example of the chickens coming home to roost. And so what he means by that is that all of the hate that America's been pushing towards the African Americans, all the hate that they have in the society finally bit them. It finally came back, karma. And that's the reason why JFK died. And immediately the media killed him. They said, look at this guy was a hero, they killed him. And because of that, the Nation of Islam suspended Malcolm X. And let's just say he never returned after that suspension. So he got suspended for 90 days, but he realized after the suspension that this was an expulsion. That the people wanted him out, and he was gone. He's like, I'm basically leaving the Nation of Islam. He was under a lot of stress at that time. However, somebody called him. And someone said, Malcolm, I'm flying out your whole family to come out to me. And this person was barely known to people at this time. Anybody know who this person was?
MLK.
Muhammad Ali? Yeah, Muhammad Ali. Nice. Now, Muhammad Ali. Now, this is a very iconic photo. Now, Muhammad Ali at this time, because they were very close with one another, and Muhammad Ali got into Islam because of Malcolm X. He saw Malcolm as his older brother. Muhammad Ali invited Malcolm and his family to visit for Muhammad Ali's first fight. And this is a fight which is he's probably seen as the greatest underdog in history in this fight. Because the Nation of Islam, because at this time, Muhammad Ali was interested in the Nation of Islam. But they said, this guy's got no chance. Screw this guy. The media said, screw Muhammad Ali. He's going to lose. Everyone bet on Sonny Liston. Sonny Liston's going to dismantle him. Malcolm and his family were the only ones on his side. And Muhammad Ali won that fight. And he became heavyweight champion. You know, his party was very simple. He hung out with Malcolm's family and, you know, they just had dinner. The next day, Muhammad Ali publicly stated, I'm part of the Nation of Islam. I have converted. And right away, the Nation of Islam jumped on his bandwagon. They jumped on it because they saw that, you know, everybody wanted Muhammad Ali now. He was super famous. He's the heavyweight champion of the world. And so they said, he's part of us now. And they gained more publicity because of that. Now, Malcolm returned home, and now life begins after the Nation of Islam. So he officially cut ties with the Nation of Islam, and he created his own organization, the Muslim Mosque Organization. Now, this is very important. He decided to make a change in his life. He's like, there's something in me. I need to do this. He's like, I just really need to do this. So he goes to his sister and he gets money. He's like, I need to perform Hajj. He's like, I have to go perform Hajj now. He's like, I'm under a lot of strain. I just have to do it. And he goes and he sets out for Hajj. And this is the moment of Malcolm's life where it's called Malcolm at Mecca. Because he goes to commit his Hajj. Now, does anybody know who he's sitting with? Anybody know? Now, initially, Malcolm was not let in to Hajj because they thought he wasn't a Sunni Muslim. They thought he was part of the Nation of Islam still. So it took him a while. And there's a funny incident that happens. He's sitting in a room, and it's with all these Arabs. All these Arabs, all these Africans that don't have their visa. And he only knows English. And he's like, how do I talk to these guys? He's like, I gotta start a conversation with him. And so he's like, because there's a lot of people in the room, he's like, Muhammad Ali. And everybody looks at him. Everybody. Because Muhammad Ali was an iconic figure at that time. Everybody knew him. And they're like, you're Muhammad Ali? You? And he's like, and obviously he can't communicate, right? They just point like, Ali? Ali? And he's like, no. He's like, I'm Malcolm. A couple people understood. But then word spread around everywhere in Mecca that Muhammad Ali was coming Hajj. And whenever they saw him, they're like, oh, Muhammad Ali. So he found that hilarious. Now, again, so he set out by himself. And so he had nobody with him. And eventually, you know, he got in and he started performing his Hajj. And he says, in Mecca, you could be a king or you could be a beggar. But nobody would know because we're all wearing the same thing. And something which is very interesting is at that time, it was extremely rare for an American Muslim to be performing Hajj. Everywhere he went, when people found out he was an American Muslim, he was treated like a king. People loved him just because there was never an American. They didn't even know America had Muslims at that time. So he was treated like a king. And so Prince Faisal found out, and Prince Faisal made him a guest of the state. And he's like, I'm going to give you your own suite. I'm going to give you your own chauffeur, your own car, everything. He's like, I'm treating you like a king, because the world knew about Malcolm at that point. And he was asked what he loved most about Mecca. And he said the brotherhood. The people of all races, colors, from all over the world, coming together as one. It has proved to me the power of one God. The color blindness that I saw in the Muslim world shocked me. Because I began to realize that white people were normal humans as well. That they were not inherently the devils. Because when he went there, he saw Arabs. And the Arabs had white skin. And he was eating out of the same plate as them. Drinking water from the same cup as them. And he began to see them as his brothers. So he began to question his ideology. He's like, these people can't be devils. And so he comes to the conclusion that the white people in America, when they say they're white, they're saying, I'm boss. That's what they're referring to. When they say, I'm white. But the white people in the Arab world, it was just a characteristic of theirs. Like, we just had white skin. That's it. Like, we're the same as everyone. And this blew his mind, and it shattered his whole ideology that white people were inherently evil. And he began to self-reflect at that time. And at that time is when he began to realize that he was being followed by a CIA agent. And the CIA agent was following him throughout his entire travels. And so Malcolm writes a letter, which shocks everyone, about Hajj, and it gets sent back to America. And I'm just going to show you the video of someone reading out the letter.
Such sincere hospitality and overwhelming spirit of true brotherhood as is practiced by people of all colors and races here in this ancient holy land, the home of Abraham, Muhammad, and all the other prophets of the Holy Scriptures. For the past week, I've been utterly speechless and spellbound by the graciousness I see displayed all around me by people of all colors. I've been blessed to visit the holy city of Mecca. I've made my 7 circuits around the Kaaba. I drank water from the well of the Zamzam. I ran 7 times back and forth between the hills of Mount Al-Safa and Al-Marwa. I've prayed in the ancient city of Mina, and I've prayed on Mount Arafat. There were tens of thousands of pilgrims from all over the world. They were of all colors, from blue-white blondes to black-skinned Africans. But we were all participating in the same ritual, displaying a spirit of unity and brotherhood that my experiences in America had led me to believe never could exist between the white and non-white. America needs to understand Islam, because this is the one religion that erases from its society the race problem. Throughout my travels in the Muslim world, I have met, talked to, and even eaten with people who in America would have been considered white, but the white attitude was removed from their minds by the religion of Islam.
If I recall, I pointed out that when I was at Mecca making the pilgrimage, that I spoke about the brotherhood that existed at all levels and among all people who were there on that Hajj, who had accepted the religion of Islam. And I pointed out that for what it had done, what the religion of Islam had done for those people over there, despite their complexion differences, that it would probably do America well to study the religion of Islam, and perhaps it could drive some of the racism from this society as it has driven racism from the Muslim society.
Again, it's evident that Malcolm said later on that Islam is the only solution to remove this cancer called racism in America. So his trips in Mecca truly signified to him that Islam is a religion of unity, is a religion of all brotherhood, that this religion removed racism from that society. So maybe we could use that to remove the racism that is prevalent in America. And so he finishes his trip in Mecca. You know, he goes a lot more in depth, but because of time, I can't really go into it. But it truly began the starting point for a change. So now he makes a trip to Middle East and Africa. He goes out to Lebanon. And he goes to Lebanon and he just gives speeches. Because they invited him out. They said, we really want you here. And now he began his travels across all of Africa and the Middle East. He was constantly flying from one place to another. He would speak to the news outlets there, the radio. He would debate prominent university intellectuals about the race situation in America. And he was shocked that he went across the world and nobody knew what was going on in America. They felt that maybe there was some tensions with the African Americans. But he went there, and when he told them, they were all shocked. Like Prince Faisal was shocked when they met, and he told them about it. And so he went to Ghana, and he believed Ghana was the most beautiful country. He continued to give lectures there. Now, he met with 33 heads of state in Africa. He met one person he really loved was Gamal Abdel Nasser of Egypt. And he met with Nasser multiple times. He met with President Nkrumah of Ghana. He traveled all across Africa. And what he wanted to do was, he wanted to unite all of Africa together. This concept of Pan-Africanism. He wanted to unite all of these African countries together, and he wanted them to denounce together what America was doing, and to take it to the UN also. He wanted to bring them all together. Because something that really angered him is that the white man who was abusing the blacks in America is the same white man that stole Africa's wealth, artifacts, and minerals, and they were still here in Africa trying to rob them again. Because he could still see, because he talked about how, you know, fossils today are still being found in Africa. They're not being found in America. These artifacts are being found in Africa, not in America. And it shows him that Africa was, you know, a beautiful civilization. And he studied the various civilizations within Ghana. And so again, he wanted to unite all of them. Now, like I said, Malcolm was very vocal. He would sit in parliament with all of these heads of states. And he would just criticize them to their face. He says, you guys are denouncing what's going on in South Africa, and I believe Portugal, the racism there, the apartheid in South Africa, but you're not saying anything about America. We got 22 million African Americans, and you're not saying anything about them. Like, step up your game. He went to Prince Faisal. He went to King Prince Faisal's face. And Prince Faisal said, you know, you guys are teaching the wrong Islam there. What are you guys doing? He's like, you guys neglected us. You guys sit here acting almighty, and well, obviously the wrong Islam's there because you guys aren't doing anything there. You guys aren't giving da'wah there. That's why there's no Islam there. So he was criticizing these men to their faces. And so later he would create his organization called the Organization of African American Unity. And he wanted to unite Africa together. That was his goal. Now, a key thing that Malcolm says is that although he split with the Nation of Islam, he did not want to criticize them because he's like, the white man wants us to go against our own black people. Like, that's what they want. So he did not criticize Elijah Muhammad until later on. Now, he actually, this is something I just found out recently. He actually went to Palestine. He went to the Gaza camps there, and he met with many of them. And so he says, did the Zionists have the legal or moral right to invade Arab Palestine, uproot its Arab citizens from their homes, and seize all their property for themselves, just based on the religious claim that their forefathers lived here 3,000 years ago? Only 1,000 years ago, the Moors lived in Spain. Would this give the Moors the legal and moral right to invade the Iberian Peninsula, drive out its Spanish citizens, and then set up a Moroccan nation where Spain used to be, as the European Zionists have done to our Arab brothers and sisters in Palestine? And so, does anybody know Harun Hashim Rashid? Who is he? He was a very famous poet in Palestine. And he would talk to Malcolm about all of these things. And he said, Malcolm came to Gaza with a strong desire to learn about the Palestinian cause. He was a true Muslim who shed many tears when he was hearing about the tragedies of Palestine. He was a humanist and Muslim in his essence. Malcolm wasn't just dedicated to the freedom of his own people, but the freedom of all oppressed people across the world. So he became heavily involved in international politics. He wrote, in his diary, he talks a lot about his trip in Palestine, his trip in Egypt. He has a whole book, which I just recently read. It's his diary of his trip to Mecca and his trip to Africa and the Middle East. And so one thing he says, it's so difficult to believe that I was widely known here and respected on this continent. So the negative image the Western press had tried to paint of me didn't succeed. He said, I went to the Middle East and everyone loved me there. He said, I went to Africa, everyone loved me there. He said, nobody hated me. The only people that hated me were the people in America. Everybody else loved me. And so this is not, even though he never met these people. Now this is something very, very important. Historians argue that if Malcolm had a couple more trips to Africa and the Middle East, he would have sealed many of the deals he set in motion, despite the nervous, narrow-mindedness of many of the few African leaders worried about the relationship with the U.S. So the historians argue that if Malcolm made more trips out here, he actually would have succeeded and united Africa together. And if he actually united Africa together, the implications would have been lasting. It would have been drastic. But he didn't make those trips out there. Yeah. So just to conclude his Middle East and Africa trip, he was just going out there meeting with all of the heads of state, and he was just telling them about what America was doing and why we needed to unite and go against them. And so eventually he heads back to America. He heads back to America, and he doesn't really have an organization because he's split with the Nation of Islam. And when he landed at his airport, the airport was packed because they read his letters and they knew he changed. All the media was there, his family was there, everybody was there to greet him. And then he became incredibly busy. Every day he was on a news outlet, he was giving interviews, debating lectures. So I had to cancel so many lectures again at like Harvard and these places because I was just so busy and everybody wanted me. And so he went and he said, my views have changed. I don't believe white people are inherently the devils, and I will stop making these blanket statements. He said, there were some people who were in fact good and actually wanted to help out, but there were still others who were evil. Now, after the statement, his image from white people began to become better. And there's an incident, there's an event where he's driving and he reaches a red light. And a car pulls up beside him, and it's white folks. And they look at him, and he's like, oh, it's Malcolm. And the guy's like, it's a white guy. He's like, can I shake your hand, Malcolm? He's like, do you mind shaking the hand of a white man? And Malcolm says, I don't have a problem shaking hands with another human being. And it begins to show, you know, the development that was going on in Malcolm, that he didn't see white people as evil. And he began to work with white people a lot. Now, just before Salah, 1965. Now, 1965 is the last chapter in Malcolm's autobiography. So this is where he began to get a lot of problems with the Nation of Islam. The Nation of Islam, because he wasn't with them anymore, they decided to kick Malcolm out of the house because they were financing the house. And at that time, Malcolm's wife, Betty, was pregnant, and he had children. He was under a bunch of stress. And he didn't have anywhere to go because he devoted his whole life to the nation. And so now he came out publicly exposing the Nation of Islam. Every single thing he went, just like exposing them. And one thing that got him a lot of flack is he came out and he said the Nation of Islam is working with the KKK. He said the KKK promised to give them a county for them to live at, and that these groups were going to start working together. And the Nation of Islam got pissed. They got pissed. And then, you know, eventually Malcolm and his family had to leave the house. One night Malcolm and his family were sleeping, and the house was set on fire. The entire house was set on fire. And Malcolm woke up late at night, he grabbed his children, they ran out, and the entire house just burnt to the ground. Everything. And at this point, Malcolm, you know, he told Alex Haley, the one who wrote the autobiography, he said, my mind is just buzzed. He's like, I'm just exhausted. Like, I can't take this anymore. And that incident really just pushed him to the edge, and he was like, I'm done. He said, I'm going to expose the Nation of Islam, and all of their members are trying to kill me at the Audubon Ballroom Hall. And he has planned out, he was going to expose all of that. And so this is very significant. This scene that I'm going to show you is very important. Now, the man driving the car is Muhammad Ali.
Mm-hmm. nominated.
What you doing in my pockets, man? Get your hand out of my pocket!
Hold it, my brother.
Stop sleeping and get your hand out of
my pocket! Just be cool. Be cool.
So, on February 21st, 1965, Malcolm X was murdered before he gave the speech where he was going to expose the Nation of Islam. He was shot 7 times. The first shot was a shotgun bullet that basically almost immediately killed him. It gave him 13 wounds in his heart, and then it was followed by another shotgun blast, and then later on, 5 bullets from a pistol. And so, there's a lot of speculation as to what exactly happened afterwards, because they called the police, but the police took forever to show up. That they actually went, the people in the hall ran to the hospital, brought a stretcher back, put Malcolm on the stretcher, took him to the hospital before the cops even came. And even when the cops came, they came in and they were just slowly walking, and you know, they barely did anything. So there's a lot of conspiracy as to what exactly happened. Now, a couple of days beforehand, or I believe a week ago, Malcolm actually asked for a permit to carry a gun, but it never went through for some reason. And so there's a lot of speculation as to what exactly happened, but the men who did kill him were indeed part of the Nation of Islam. And Malcolm says in his autobiography that, at a young age, I knew I was going to die from violence. I knew I wasn't going to live a long life, just because of what happened with my father. And so something I find very interesting is Malcolm said, "Assalamu alaikum," and he got shot. Which is very similar to the mosque shooting, where the brother said, "Assalamu alaikum," and he got shot as well. And you know, it's just, you know, you're greeting everyone with peace, and you end up getting shot. So yeah, just a couple more things. The Nation of Islam, and so the reason why Malcolm never went against the Nation of Islam, because he never wanted black-on-black crime to happen. Now what happened afterwards is people from Malcolm's mosque went and burnt down the Nation of Islam mosque, then the Nation of Islam responded, and this cycle of black violence just kept going on and on and on. And so most of the world began to mourn Malcolm's loss. Martin Luther King was sad, James Baldwin was sad. People around the world began to mourn Malcolm, especially his closest people. Malcolm's family didn't really have any income, and the people of Harlem worked together to buy a house for Malcolm's family and to take care of his mother and the children, Malcolm's wife and their children. Because he was devoted to the Nation of Islam and put his entire life into it, and he made no money. And so because of that, Malcolm was killed, and Malcolm says, to end off his autobiography, subhanAllah, something very beautiful. Because this last chapter, 1965, if you read his autobiography, he says, "I'm going to die. I know I'm going to die." And he writes everything, all of his regrets. He talks about how he says, you know, "I really wish, even though I was this intellect, I really wish I got a formal, an academic education. He said, I wish I could have been a lawyer. I hate the fact that that teacher told me that I couldn't be a lawyer. And because of that, I dropped out of school." He said, "I hated that." And he ends off his autobiography. He says, "For the 22 million African Americans, you know, I did my best for you guys. If I changed the life of one person, I'm truly grateful. He said, all I ever wanted to do was take care of you guys. And he said something interesting back then. He said, I was the only American Muslim flying on the way back from Hajj. He's like, I hope one day that there will be multiple planes flying from America to Hajj. And America begins to, the Muslims in America begin to grow. So he says, the ending of his autobiography, all the good that I've ever done is thanks to Allah. And all of the evil that I've ever done is attributed to me, not Allah. And that's how he ends his autobiography.
SubhanAllah.
Very beautiful. Now, we're going to break for Salah. After Salah, we're going to eat pizza. And then afterwards, I'm just going to go over his legacy. Because his legacy, it's easy to find out what happened in Malcolm's life. You can pull up all these books and just figure out what happened. But his legacy and why Muslims here need to understand Malcolm's life and the life lessons, especially Muslims in activism. If you're a Muslim activist, you really need to understand Malcolm. And that's what I'm going to explain in the legacy. So we're just going to break for Salah right now, and inshallah we'll continue. Okay, so I only have about like 10-15 minutes left, but I want to wrap all of this up with the legacy. Because like I mentioned earlier on, it's easy to open up a book and find out what happened in his life. It's very easy to find that out. But to figure out his legacy, it takes a lot more work. I consulted with some of my professors who taught entire classes on Malcolm X at SFU. And, you know, I've come up with a lot of points. But the one thing you're going to notice is, because I know people are going to do research after this on Malcolm, is that his legacy is sanitized. It's been filtered. I mean, it's very obvious. In America, they have MLK Day, right? They have Martin Luther King Day, a whole holiday. They push this I Have a Dream. Everybody knows about him. Everybody knows about Rosa Parks. But Malcolm is often neglected. And the only time you'll really hear people talk about Malcolm is on February 21st, which is the anniversary of his death. That's really the only time when you'll hear people mention Malcolm X. Now, one thing I always tell everyone is to read the autobiography, because without that book, we wouldn't have Malcolm's legacy today. That book really, without that book, Malcolm X would not be Malcolm X. He would have been forgotten throughout history as just some other black nationalist. But because he made that book, and like he stated, I spent many hours to make this book, not just 1 hour, because I could have made this book in 1 hour, but then it would have been an okay book. But I saw the book here somewhere. Someone had a book on the table? Right? On the back of the book, it shows Times Magazine said that the autobiography of Malcolm X is one of the greatest books in the 20th century. One of the greatest books. And that book is how we get his legacy. Now, the New York Times reported after Malcolm's death that a meeting of Negro intellectuals had agreed upon that MLK could secure the allegiance of the middle and upper class of the African Americans, but Malcolm alone could only gain the allegiance of the lower class. He said, because the Negroes respect Malcolm X because they sense in these men absolute integrity and they know they will never sell them out. Malcolm X could not be corrupted, and African Americans know this and therefore respect him. So just picture this, picture their society, right? 1960s African Americans. The vast majority of African Americans are in the lower class. The vast majority. They had the occasional PhDs and some were in the middle class, but the vast majority were the lower class. And so the upper class and middle class, you know, they loved MLK because MLK had a similar lifestyle to them. But the lower class, they couldn't relate to MLK. So, okay, here's this African-American lawyer who, you know, he had it easy, basically. But when they look at Malcolm, they see themselves. They see that this is a man that went through prison. He was a drug dealer, a gambler. He did all this just like us. And if he can do this, then we can do this as well. So it truly liberated these African-Americans because they could relate to Malcolm. They know that he came from the lower depths just like them. Now, after Malcolm passed away, there were many Muslim countries that put out statements about Malcolm. Pakistan made an announcement, Pakistan, even though he never went to Pakistan. The Pakistan newspaper wrote an article about Malcolm. However, they said, you know, a small excerpt is, Malcolm was a great Negro leader. His death is a definite setback to the Negro movement for emancipation in America. The Nigerian newspaper said that Malcolm was a dedicated and consistent disciple of the movement for the emancipation of his brethren, no one can doubt. Malcolm X fought and died for what he believed to be right. He will have a place in the palace of martyrs. And a very interesting thing Malcolm says at the end of his autobiography is that he said the people that end up changing societies are usually the ones that are murdered by it. And just looking at America, we can see Abraham Lincoln. Abraham Lincoln was murdered a couple days after he created the Emancipation Proclamation. Martin Luther King was massacred. Malcolm X was massacred. And he said that, you know, all I ever did, he said people will say I'm anti-Semitic. People will say I'm a racist. People will say these things. He said all I did was I held up a mirror. And I just reflected the crimes that the white man did to our people. That's all I'm doing. They said, you're anti-Semitic. He said, all I do is I speak truth. And if by speaking truth, I'm a racist or I'm anti-Semitic, then, you know, power to you, right? But Malcolm, all he was doing was stating the crimes of that the white Americans have committed against the African Americans. Now, Malcolm X's legacy, his impact on America, especially the Muslim community in America. I have family in America. I talk to them. As soon as I mention Malcolm X, they know everything. Malcolm X is prominent in America. In Canada, we don't know too much about him. We just remember his name and other parts of the world. But subhanAllah, the amount of people who convert to Islam because of Malcolm X is remarkable. It is remarkable. Just go on YouTube and just search conversion to Islam video. And I guarantee you 50% of the videos will cite Malcolm or his autobiography. I was just watching these videos last night. They all just kept saying the same thing. And the biggest area is in the prison setting, as I mentioned before. In the prison setting, these people are neglected. They see the way that they've been treated by society. And one of the most common books in prisons is the autobiography of Malcolm X. And they read his autobiography. And because of that, so many people convert to Islam. So our first part of Knowledge Circle on Malcolm X was conducted by Brother Asadullah. And Brother Asadullah goes to prisons and he actually gives da'wah. And he actually mentions Malcolm X there. And he talks to them about Malcolm X because Malcolm's a prominent figure. On YouTube, there are multiple documentaries about the prison setting, about why Islam is the fastest growing religion in the prison sphere. Like, it's remarkable. The person's been neglected by society. Their family probably don't even want to communicate with them, but somehow they always find Islam. Why is it that they always find Islam? And I remember I was watching one video, and they said a story that really impacted them is the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, where Yusuf alayhi salam was in the prison. But again, the story of Malcolm X, I can only say this, because I can say this to you, that Malcolm has affected American Muslims, the African-American community in America. But once you go out and you watch these videos, once you go out and you actually hear what people say, it'll truly leave an impact on you. And there's a video I'm going to show, which is remarkable. And I watch this all the time now, about the legacy of Malcolm X.
Was a firm believer in the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And because of that, he never wavered in his efforts to keep going. You know, we become so supersonic and highfalutin in our understanding of the religion that basic fundamental issues like salvation, basic fundamental issues like heaven and hell, associated with the unseen, the materialistic impulses of our society weigh so heavily on our soul. The akhirah becomes an intellectual construct and not something real that motivates, that defines, motivates, and limits our actions. The promise of paradise and the threat of hell. Malcolm X believed in that.
Now listen to what he says right now.
Sat with Betty Shabazz in the 96th Street Masjid in New York City and spoke to her. And she spoke about the faith of her husband. And she said, the nationalists have claimed Malcolm. The socialists have claimed Malcolm. So it is time for you Muslims to claim Malcolm. Because he was a believer. He was a believer. You can see the change in his demeanor as his faith grew. You can see the change in his appearance as his faith grew. But one thing that didn't change, his commitment didn't change. You know, we got the, I used to run track, I ran relay, 4x110. You get the baton and you pass it on. You drop it, everyone loses. People before us passed us this baton. And in the 20th century, it was a hard leg of the race. It was a time of colonization at the beginning of the century. It was a time of nationalist and secularist, socialist, communist regimes who inherited the states that were carved out by the colonizers. There was open war on Muslims. Muslim culture, customs, belief were denigrated, ridiculed. It was difficult to be a Muslim. But despite all of those hardships, that baton was put in our hand. Are we going to drop it? Are we going to pass it on? If we're going to pass it on, you're going to have to run with strength. Malcolm ran with strength. Malcolm ran with strength, and Malcolm was one of the people that passed us that baton. And he passed it on with his blood, not with his words, with his blood. You're going to drop it, or you're going to get in the race, run hard, and pass it on to those after you? That is the question before us. So Malcolm, through his struggle, through his effort, through his sacrifice, he was a purified soul. And because he was a purified soul, he could follow the truth wherever it led him.
Now, I don't know if he noticed about the crowd that was sitting there. The vast majority of the people in the crowd were actually converts to Islam. And I saw a statistic that said that 50% of African Americans, 50% of African American Muslims converted to Islam. 50% of them, which is truly powerful. And again, Malcolm X is a huge reason why. Today, we see the rise of many prominent activist groups. Right after the assassination of Malcolm X, the Black Panther Party was created. Does anybody know about the Black Panther Party? Yeah? Okay, nice. Yeah, so the Black Panther Party based its ideology off of Malcolm X. And they cite Malcolm X as their inspiration. I know there's a lot of guys here that love the football. In the NFL, we had an athlete named Colin Kaepernick who took a knee during the national anthem. And Colin Kaepernick said that his biggest inspiration is Malcolm X. That Malcolm X is the reason why he began all of this activism. President Barack Obama cites Malcolm X and the autobiography for huge inspirations in his life. LeBron James cites Malcolm X. And the biggest, one of the most prominent social activist groups nowadays is Black Lives Matter. And Black Lives Matter is based off of Malcolm X. It's based off of his ideology. Without Malcolm X, you would not see Black Lives Matter. And if you listen to interviews from them, they always quote Malcolm X. Always. And because of that, a lot of them actually have a lot of respect for Muslims. I was watching an interview in Dallas outside of a mosque. They were like white supremacists with all their guns outside. And the Black Panther Party actually came and they responded, they brought their guns outside too, which wasn't a good idea. But nonetheless, it deterred the other group from coming. And when asked, they said, you know, we respect the Muslims a lot. We respect their faith. And a big reason why is because of Malcolm X. It's because Malcolm X is the criteria for activism, especially in America. Like, I guarantee you, if you look at all of the prominent activists, they will always cite Malcolm X. And the interesting thing is that they rarely cite MLK. They always cite Malcolm, because MLK was more of the approach that we should be peaceful, that we should be working with people. Whereas Malcolm was of the approach that of self-defense. Right? Malcolm got a lot of criticism because he said that if the police have guns and they were abusing us, then we should have guns as well. It only makes sense. And the media said, oh, the Black Muslim movement, they want to have guns, they're extremists, blah, blah, blah. Look at MLK. And Malcolm said, he wrote in a letter to MLK, he said, you know, I don't know if he was joking or not, but he's like, the reason why I'm so extremist is that when these white people come and they look at me, they're like, MLK isn't that bad. Like, MLK doesn't call us devils. He's a nice guy. And the relationship between Malcolm and MLK is something, if people are interested, I can go into it. But again, and the and it's very interesting, because nowadays, after the mosque shooting, a lot of people are claiming the reason why is because of white supremacy. And the biggest, the most interesting thing is Malcolm's number one opponent was white supremacy. He was at war with white supremacy his entire life. He was always against it. The fact that white people are seen as superior to black people, that's what Malcolm was against. This is what he fought against. So by looking into Malcolm's life and the political views that he had, especially towards a lot of entities, I'm not going to say the name because I'm being recorded, but there are certain entities which he was against, and he got a lot of flack for, a lot of criticism, because he spoke his mind, like he said, I speak the truth. And the biggest impact on him was the liberation of the African Americans. Just think of Malcolm before prison, when he was a drug dealer and gambler. Now imagine hundreds of thousands of people turned from that to a lesser version of Malcolm X. And that's what the Nation of Islam was doing. The Nation of Islam caught a lot of flack, but they were getting rid of addictions, they were liberating these people, they were teaching them history, they did a lot of great things. But the one thing you'll notice is when you search up Malcolm X, when you search up the Nation of Islam, it's just a bunch of criticism. But like I said, history's been sanitized. And lastly, there's a verse. So I gave, since the mosque shooting, I've given three speeches on it. And I've quoted a verse in the Quran every single time. There's one verse I always mention, and it's a verse that everyone's familiar with. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ قُتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتَ بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ يُرْزَقُونَ. That don't think of those who have died in the cause of Allah as dead, but rather they are alive, and they are with their Lord, and they are receiving His sustenance, His provision. Now I remember I was reading articles on Malcolm, and because one thing about Malcolm that I haven't mentioned, does anybody know how old Malcolm was when he passed away? 39. He was 39 when he passed away. The prophets begin at like 40. SubhanAllah. Maybe Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started at 40. That's when he truly made his impact. Malcolm passed away at 39. 39. So historians are always wondering, what would have happened if this man lived, if this man survived? Because the one thing Malcolm had is knowledge, but Malcolm didn't have wisdom. And wisdom only comes with time. And if Malcolm was given that time, and you can see, one thing you'll notice is when you listen to his lectures, it's before he converts to Sunni Islam, all of his speeches have so much hate. So much hate, he's just attacking the white man. But then once he converts to Islam, he's very calm and peaceful. And that's why nobody wants to listen to Malcolm after Mecca. Nobody wants to listen to him because he was very confused at that age, at that time. He didn't know what really was the cause. Before, he just thought it was complete segregation. We need to completely segregate from them. Whereas MLK was from the perspective that we need to integrate. But it's a question that nobody can answer. What would have happened if Malcolm had not passed away? He had the knowledge. He was meeting with all of these leaders. Like, it's something that we'll never have the answer to. But like the verse in the Quran says, don't think of those who have died in the cause of Allah is dead. Rather, they're alive, they're with their Lord, and they're receiving His provision. So that's all I have for now. Does anybody have any questions or comments about anything? I'm hoping